We begin with our first session in this hall, which is marketing, which is the first session in marketing on mobile touch points across brand marketing. I would like to invite our panelists to please join us on stage. Mr. Lavin, Punjabi, President of Affinity. Mr. Venkatesh, CR, Founder of Adatha. Mr. Prabhakar, Tiwari, Chief Marketing Officer at PayU. And Mr. Sharad, Harjai, AVP for Marketing at Grofers. And to moderate this session, I would like to invite Mr. Raj Singh, Managing Director of Tech Mobia. It will be a one-hour discussion, including question answers.
So welcome all to this session on touch points across brand marketing. So I think we have a very interesting panel here today with a good mix of different people across the industry. So we have Lavin and Venkatesh, who are from the brand solution side, very much working with publishers, enabling brands to be able to touch consumers using those publisher networks. And we have Sharad from Grofers, who is very much on the brand side. So clearly, you know, what are they looking at? How are they using this? And then we also have Prabhakar from PayU, so which is also one in the enabling space, but clearly also a brand, very strong brand in this space as well. So the topic, mobile touch points across brand marketing. So clearly this is, we're here, we know mobile is a huge industry in terms of handsets, something like probably maybe 100 million smartphones will be purchased by Indians in 2016, so it's very much the direction that we're going, which is internet consumption through mobile devices, smartphones, consumers are there, you're using it, I'm using it all the time in terms of screen time. So that is where the eyeballs are. And the session today is really to look at, you know, what are the ways that marketers are leveraging that as an effective touch point across the whole consideration funnel, you know, where we, from the awareness through to the transaction side, what do they go beyond that as well? And also touching on some of the features that the device has and how those are being leveraged as well. You know, we've got geo capabilities, we've got motion sensors in devices as well. How are the ways that some of those are being used as well? So hopefully we'll get some insights from my colleagues here as well. So we're going to start. I'm going to just hand over and we can go this way. So closest for myself, and I'll give a few minutes and let them share a few viewpoints on the subject.
Sure. Thanks, Raj. Good morning, everyone. I always like to start off by understanding my audience. So, quick show of hands, how many brands over here? A few of them. How many solution providers? Or, okay, publishers? A few. Who are the rest of you? Press? How many press? Okay. All right. So, as Raj mentioned, mobile is definitely growing. We see that everyone's spending a lot more time on mobile. Well, a quick show of hands again. How many of you guys woke up with a mobile phone this morning? Like, the first thing you did was access your mobile phone. That's a lot of you guys, right? You see that? That's a changing trend already, right? You do that, your kids do that, your parents are doing that, everyone's doing that right now. So, which means everyone's spending a lot more time on mobile. It's a given fact, right? There's data against it. There's about 4.5 hours of time spent on mobile by Indians every day, which is huge, which is actually, 4.5 hours is the overall time spent on any sort of media, whether this is mobile, whether this is TV, print, whatever have you, and then 45% of that is on mobile already in India as of last year, which means that there's a lot of time spent on mobile, but there's an interesting fact too, that only 2% of the budgets of any marketers actually go into mobile. So there's a lot of time spent, a lot of eyeballs, but very few brands are there. That's just because you brands just don't get it. Most brands don't get it. Like, most of the traditional brands just don't understand it. Modern digital brands, like, you know, mobile first brands, they sort of understand the importance of mobile, but I think a lot of the older brands, you really need a serious catching up to do. Right, so that's about the time spent on mobile, right? So we as a company, what we do is, you know, we help brand marketers really bridge that gap. We realize there's a big gap in the industry where brands want to do something exciting on mobile, but they're so stuck in their age-old ways of doing stuff on, you know, desktop and, you know, offline, that when you tell them mobile solutions, the first thing is, okay, I don't understand this. You know, that's their first reaction. So we're sort of bridging that gap by actually we've created a solution that actually speaks to consumers while they're browsing content. So think of it this way. What do you spend most of your time on mobile with? So first thing, some people spend a lot of time on social, right? So social media, you got to have your ads in social media. With social media, there are always outbound links which lead you to various different publishers, whether this be newspaper sites or whatever have you. You got to have effective ads there too. Then when you're searching, you got to have ads on search as well. You got to have ads in your email, because that's another important, you're spending a lot of time on email as well. So across all these different touch points, you've got to have effective mobile advertising, right? Effective mobile ads. What we're focused on specifically, Affinity as a company, is mCanvas, which is specifically around the content consumption. So when users are reading content, what we do is we introduce a little ad unit. Now, this ad unit is very different from your typical banner ads. Very highly engaging. They're a storytelling experience. So that's something that we realized that brands needed, and we created something like that. And we've got a lot of learnings from that, which basically, tells us that brand, there's a huge gap in the market where brands need effective storytelling solutions, and there are very few solutions out there. So we're one of the first vendors who are doing this in India, and we're seeing great success. So yeah, with that, let's hand over the other speakers here, and then let's engage in more conversation.
Thanks, Lavin. Very good morning. So just a simple question I'm going to ask, and the person who answers first is going to get a gift. So the first person, please let me know what's the time. Quickly. Okay. There you go. You'll tell your mobile first. So that's how things have changed.
What was the price?
I think that's you. Okay. So things are changing. We are all going from the from a different era, like what Lavin said. It's all, we're looking at they're using the mobile for almost everything. People have started using, they've ditched the watches. And they have gone to those, and again, there's a shift again which is happening. People are talking about the wearables, so again, it's some shift. But again, it's connected to the mobile. So, with a lot of these happening, so I'm going to tell you a few things, share a few insights on how brands are actually making use of this mobile technology. First, about my company. So, we run a company called Adatha. So, we call ourselves the mother of all ad networks. So the reason we will explain to you, I'll explain to you a bit later. So what we do is, like, we help brands to get users for their mobile apps. So basically, anybody in the industry who wants to acquire users, get more installs for their apps, we are the perfect, we help them out. We connect them to the publishers to get user acquisition. So what we tell the brands, when brands come to us and talk to us about user acquisition, we tell them, start thinking of other ways, not just the TV media or the print media, think of the mobile media, because a lot of media houses are still, they are thinking that, the television or the print newspaper media is actually more effective. But we are trying to say that, bring a combination of that along with the mobile. Because a lot of brands who are still yet to get into the mobile front, probably they are doing it in a very small way. They're not engaging as much as they could, actually. So it's not just, I was discussing a few points with Lavin about does every brand need to have a mobile app? Of course, it's not that you definitely need to, but it's in some way a presence is definitely good options. So, for example, we were discussing about maybe a scooter company, or maybe you could look at a washing machine or something like that. Why would they go for something like a mobile app? So, whereas a brand like, you know, Myntra or somebody like Grofers or somebody would definitely go for a mobile app. So what we do is, like, you know, we actually found that when we were discussing with brands, we found that a lot of these brands are getting misled by a few agencies. So what happens is, like, they pump in a lot of budget and say that, okay, we'll get you users, and what happens is, like, there is a huge amount of users, but the quality of users again is a major issue. So there we are. I mean, probably, you know, when we go into detail, we can talk about incentivized or non-incentivized users, and you know, how we can acquire them and all that. So, but we what we do is, like, we help balance it and try to get good quality users. So that's what we do. So, during the thing of discussion, I'll share with you some examples on how we have helped certain brands.
Hi, very good morning to you all, and very good morning to my panel fellow members. So, Lavin and Venkatesh have given a good momentum, actually. They have asked a few questions which I would ask myself. So, the first thing I know for a fact that a lot of brand marketers are here, okay? And there are some solution providers and some publishers. So, I will play to my audience, okay? So the reason why a lot of brand marketers are there, like, I think a lot of brand marketers, see, I come from a very old economy. I started my career way back in 04 with Parachute, Marico. And I did my first ATL campaign in 04 when I was a management trainee. Did my first outdoor and print campaign just out of college, okay? So I'm a very, very old when it comes to media and all, okay? So a lot of brand marketers today will be asking the question that, you know, I mean, what is it? I mean, is the digital marketing the thing? Or whatever we learned earlier in a conventional marketing will apply. So my answer to that is in a line, and basically this is the line which is my philosophy, and this is what I kind of preach everywhere, that the world doesn't need a good digital marketeer. Rather, the world needs its great marketeer all over again. Because a good marketeer focuses on consumers, and the media happens automatically. There's no mobile first, there's a consumer first. And if consumer has gone mobile, you'll figure out things. Now that's my, we'll talk more about it. Now a couple of more things, okay? Now other things that should help your thinking. From the media side first, let's start from there. And this is a view for solution providers, publishers, and even to brand marketers. Imagine, we always talk, when should I use TV, what should be our lead medium, print, outdoors, radio, and all of that. Imagine if there is one medium, which is a combination of TV, radio, print, and outdoors. How will you use it? It can give you the best of TV, it can give you the best of radio, it can get you the best of print, it can give you the best of the outdoors. Right? Moreover, whatever your consumer see will come to know. Imagine. So there's the power. Okay, so but don't get obsessed with that power. You have to sell your ideas, product, and services, and that's where the consumer comes in. So that's my thought number one, which I will elaborate as we move along. And the second is consumer. Consumer remains what consumer is. I mean, from the time Mr. Philip Kotler decided to read, wrote his first edition of the book, I mean, consumer is looking for three things in a very precise manner. And I've seen it, like, across selling hair oil, yogurt, tire, lipstick, consumer tech, and I've done that all. There are three things we ask. First, what's the uniqueness? What is the impact? What is the new news there? That's the first thing, you have to get it right. Second is, what is the likability? Will they like it? It's not, it's unique, it's shocking, but do they like it? And third is, what is the engagement intent? I'm not using purchase intent at this stage. I'm saying, what is the engagement intent? Will they like to know more about it? Will they like to do something with it? So if you think from media and consumers in that angle, then things are easily solvable. And the last thing is, like, currently I'm CMO with PayU Money, and I did my campaign called Faide Ki Adat way back in September, October. And the campaign did very well in ATL, and in fact, my brand track, my unaided awareness, a lot of parameters went through the roof. But more importantly, the same TV content did very well in Google. So my view-through rate were 27% for 6 weeks. Some of you who know this number will understand what numbers I'm talking about. My click-through rate was 1.5% in a YouTube kind of media. My GSP open rate was roughly 11%. The point I'm making is that the content I made for TV, but the content worked on digital. The point I'm making is if you're a good marketer, if you can understand your consumer well, if you understand content inherently, doesn't matter where you make it, it will fly if you understand your consumers well. So I will stop here. So that's my thought. Mobile is just another medium. Know your consumer. And I will tell you in the course of conversation how I think mobile can be leveraged to engage your consumer in the best possible manner. Thank you.
Thanks, Prabhakar. Good morning, guys. Let me start by asking how many of you have used Grofers till date? The majority of you have not. So that means I've got a lot of work to do. But being a brand, right? So we have recently started a year and a half ago, and still a lot of work to be done. And as a brand, the biggest focus, like Prabhakar mentioned, right? So it is never that what are the channels that I can use to reach out to the customer. Instead, that how do I leverage that channel to where my customer or that information makes most sense for my customer, right? So I can put up hoardings and, you know, run digital ads, and there are multiple channels that we can pursue just to send out a communication that, okay, get this, buy this, we sell this, and a lot of stuff. But until and unless my customer feels connected, that, okay, yes, they're saying something and I actually need this, they're never gonna take any action against it. So as a brand, that's the biggest challenge for us too, that we need to solve. Right? What communication do I send and through which channel, and at what time that my consumer actually feels connected to the brand? It should not be that just because a consumer is using a channel, I'm just pushing some information down his throat. So finding out what are the best possible channels, what do I write, what do I say, how do I say it, which time should I send it to him? Is it in the morning, does he shop in the evening, afternoon, while he's sleeping, when is he browsing the application, when does he come to explore stuff, when does he come to shop, actually, when does he place his orders, when does he want his delivery. Everything that matters throughout the life journey of a consumer is the biggest challenge that we try to solve. So I mean, there are great digital publishing platforms available, there are, you know, old school outdoors and media places available to just reach out to your customers, but then optimizing them in a way that you will always send that communication which people feel connected with is the biggest challenge for a brand. Like Prabhakar said, right? I mean, the how consumer thinks is what you need to think. Otherwise, you will just be sending n number of messages out and probably will never be able to get the quality acquisition that you would always seek for. So over the course of next 1 hour, whenever I'll try to share as much experience that I have with the brand and, you know, how solution providers and we have worked together and how we have tried to acquire consumers. Look forward to the engagement.
Great. Okay. Thanks, Sharad. So, good. Thanks for your views, guys. I just wanted to ask one or two questions and then open it up to the audience. So about apps, and it's interesting, we raised up about should every brand have an app? And so I just want to ask this question, given that we know that everybody's got limited real estate on their phone, most people are deinstalling apps all the time as well. It's very difficult for a brand to stay on there. So where does it make sense for a brand to actually invest in creating an app, given the difficulty to retain that on a user's handset?
So the way I look at it is I'm a strong believer in mobile web. You know that everyone will be like, what are you talking about? Like, everything's app these days. But honestly, I think the app delight or the excitement or that's, you know, that whole gold rush is going to stop soon because Google's coming out with something called accelerated mobile pages. With stuff like that, what's going to happen is the mobile web's going to become much more user-friendly, much easier, much faster. And then very soon, you may not necessarily need an app. Right, so I mean, just think of it this way, right? So in the early stages of the mobile, you know, like, as you all know, like mobiles, like just come about in the last few years, right? So we're seeing this huge surge around mobile apps and yes, app stores, and you know, everyone's going to get user acquisition, and companies are getting valued around, you know, how many users and active users and DAUs and all that stuff. But like all that hype is going to, I think, fizzle away. I think mobile web pages is going to, you know, sort of overtake soon. As soon as it becomes much faster, much more friendlier, right? So lots of browsers are actually making that attempt and making it simpler. And when that happens, you may have a very app-like experience in your mobile web, and then the need for a mobile an app typically goes away. And we all know that in India, in a bandwidth-hungry country like India, people are not going to readily install apps. I mean, as much as people do today, most of them will download it only over Wi-Fi. They're not going to download it over 3G. I'm sure that, you know, Venkatesh may have more data and stats on that, but you know, these are general observations that I've made. So I think that it's a matter of time before mobile web comes back in a big way, and all of you guys who spend money on apps may just find yourself thinking, scratching your head, saying, why did we do this? But you know, it's important to understand what are you as a brand, like, what is your touch point with the consumer? Like, if that really needs to happen over an app, so if it's like companies such as, you know, like Grofers or like, you know, the Flipkarts and the Mintras, well, maybe they do need an app. But everyone does not need an app. So you really need to understand what your interaction with the client is really about. So I'll
leave
it with that.
Lavin, I totally disagree with you.
Good, that's what we need a panel for. We need some disagreement.
Mobile web making a comeback is not at all going to happen. It's dead already. At least, you know, look at a user when he gets an app, when he gets a mobile phone. So what does he have? He has got basic apps installed. He's got a few apps like, now currently, you know, there are some phones which have Facebook, Flipkart, you know, Amazon, all these eBay is installed in some mobile phones. So these are all apps which cannot be deleted, which are all part of the, you know, this phone which he has got. And these does not consume memory or whatever. So the when a first time user or the people who are starting to get into the, you know, the phone, smartphone usage, they come there and when they start seeing these apps, they think that this is only what is the web about, it's a smartphone about. So they don't know, they don't even see the browser because it's a very small icon in some part of the phone. So they look at these apps and they think, oh, it's great, you know, smartphone is great. So that's how things have started moving. And you know, when you normally look at your phone, your smartphone, you go there, you open your phone and you see, you know, apps like Twitter, you look at, you know, weather app, you look at YouTube app. You don't go to your browser and say, you know, what is the weather at this place?
Sorry, one second. Just to clear myself, when you are accessing Twitter, Facebook, or any of these different apps, and then you click on links on that, which a lot of you guys do, it opens a mobile web page. So that's still mobile web consumption, it's not app consumption, just to be clear.
But there's a total disconnect when it comes to opening that in a browser. It's totally the user experience is lost. So that's why you see, you know, let's take, for example, an NDTV app. When you click on the news, it opens the news detail within the app itself. And there is an option which, you know, it says at the bottom, a very small line, it says open in Safari. But nobody clicks that because the user experience is totally lost. So actually, see, if you look at the app, you know, yesterday there was somebody who came to visit me. I hope he's not here, somewhere here in this area. He came to me. He told me, like, you know, he's got an app and he needs to target this app to men, diabetic men patients who have done a heart surgery at least once and who are more than 50 years old and who have got 3 children. I said, what? He said, can you do this for me? I said, I can target diabetics. Yes, I can do it, but not to this level. So how different are you from VServe, InMobi and all that? I said, I mean, it's certain things are possible. Yes. Then he said, no, I want 1 lakh installs. So I said, if you're, and I told him one very important thing, I said, you get, okay, assuming you get some 10,000 users, but if your app is shit, you will, definitely the user will uninstall. So it's not just about an app or, you know, a mobile web or anything. The quality, again, is very important. So when you talk, the reason I talked about quality is the user experience in a mobile web and an app is definitely the difference is there. So people prefer the mobile app because I prefer going to Flipkart mobile app than on the mobile web. Similarly, I would prefer a good quality app rather than a junk app. So that's the reason why I totally disagree with Lavin's view.
Fair enough. We'll see what the future turns out to be. But I think the thing there is, right now, definitely user experience is definitely clear. I mean, user experience of a mobile app is superior still over a mobile web right now. However, mobile web is getting more functional, more powerful as well, and we'll see how that changes over time. The other thing I want to raise up is to the brand marketeers, so that you guys are there, in terms of mobile, this topic that we have in terms of marketing touch points where people are in the consideration phase. What have you seen in terms of the different mobile media options have been working well for you? So one, Prabhakar, you were saying about video content, right? So YouTube video content, you've seen that as well. So one of the ways that you use, what kind of mediums are you using? Are you doing pure advertising, video content, social media? What kind of ways are you trying to touch them on their mobile device in terms of your part of your audience? And also share with us all, please.
Before I talk about touch point, I have a point to make on the app per se. So, and Venkatesh made a very important point that the way I Venkatesh allowed me to kind of look back, and I bought my first smartphone way back in 08 or 09, I don't recall the exact year. And that was, by the way, BlackBerry. Not that one, the one with the full screen. I forgot the name actually. Okay, so
that was the coolest phone at the time.
Yeah,
right.
And I burned 30,000. You know, I mean, I remember that. That's how it was priced. Storm. I think this is a BlackBerry Storm. So basically, for me, the smartphone was all about app. Okay, now browser was there in the desktop. It's best in the desktop. Or smartphone was all about app. Now what Venkatesh has brought to the table is that, you know, now when the browser supremacy rises because consumers have fond about it, just because Google has realized it's losing the game. Okay, so Google has said, let's make the browser the boss, the Chrome OS, what they're talking about, right? So I'll touch upon that. The important point I want to leave behind as a brand marketer, I mean, when I talk about it, is that people in consumer install an app. They install an app, but they uninstall a brand. There's a difference. They install you for a feature that your app provides. But when they uninstall you, it's not that they don't need the feature anymore. As a brand, you have lost the game completely. You have taken that consumer liberty for granted, and you have lost out the game completely. Okay, so that's one thought that brand marketers should always think about, that while my app is there, why I'm using the app, that's the question you have to hand on heart, you have to answer. Just because my boss wants it and I have to show it in my next PPT, I mean, that can't be the reason. Okay, could be, depends. When is the appraisal due? So, but the point is that they install the app and uninstall the brand. So people need to understand. Now, let me give you a handle, both on the touchpoint bit and the app and the browser, that mobile web kind of stuff they talk about. Google is now trying to promote a concept. And now Google tries to promote a concept, it means all the tools, all the solutions will be around that concept, and of course the solution provider will also think about that concept. So as a brand guy, you rather start thinking along that line also. So what Google is talking about is a mobile micro moment. What Google is saying today is that there's something called mobile micro, there's a micro moment, or mobile micro moments, and what they're saying is that when consumers are coming to mobile, there are four things that they're looking for: to search for something, to do something, to shop something, or to go somewhere. These are four moments they look for, and in between there are micro moments. For example, a young college girl in front of her grooming kind of mirror and thinking about like how her hair should be for the college today, depending on what day it is and whom she is meeting, or he, for that matter, they would do a quick search on the browser, Google browser on their smartphone, saying that here's style for whatever, Valentine's Day, stuff like that, right? So those are the micro moments, okay? Some woman in the kitchen trying out something new in the recipe, those are the micro moments. So the point a brand should think about is that what are the micro moments in my consumer's life where the smartphone has a role to play? And if these are the micro moments, how can I serve this micro moment best? If there's a need for an app, so be it. If there's a need for a microsite, so be it. If there's a YouTube channel required, so be it. You know, so the question is, what are those micro moments in your consumer's life? And to me, this is the most important parameter for deciding on the touch points. So I think this is how it is. I'll talk more about it. But I think mobile micro moments are the key. And that's how you should decide what are the touch points and how you should use the social media and blah, blah, blah. Okay, but micro moments understanding is the key. Thanks.
Thanks, Prabhakar. So as a brand, right, so I'll just answer what Raj asked initially, that what channels do we use where people go and consume our information. I think social networks work the best for us basically for two reasons. One, because of the scale that they have. We talk about Twitter, Facebook, or anything else. The sheer amount of scale that these guys have help us reach the maximum number of customers that we can probably. And then one behavior that people actually go to these platforms to consume information, right? It's they're not going there just for a particular reason. I mean, I go to my regular website or a news website just for one particular reason, that I want to read this article or I want to do this thing and some or something else. I already have made in my mind that this is what I'm going to do when I open this web page. If something else also comes up along with it, that probably is just a little intrusive, and I in my mind I'm not looking for that information. When I go to any social media network, I am open to consume information, whatever you're going to give it. And if it is in the form where I am receptive to that, if it is in the form of something that that I'll feel connected to, it's no longer an ad, and it's more of a communication or an information that I want to consume. And I think that's what I was talking earlier as well, and that's what we need to compromise on. My consumer should never feel like something is just being sent to me just for the sake of it. Going back to the same question, I mean, mobile sites or apps, I don't think we live in an era where we can say that it's either this or that. It's always going to be mobile sites and mobile applications for different reasons. Right? I mean, we as Grofers, we made a conscious decision initially that we're not going mobile web. We're only going to be an application-based platform because of certain reasons. That might be true for Myntra or Flipkart, that might not be true for something else, that might not be true for a scooter-based one. Right? So it's a business call, and at the end of the day, that's how you build your business upon. I mean, for us, it was very important to be clear in the starting that my user behavior is always, I'm going to build a user behavior which will be on the way shopping. I don't want people to sit down for 15 minutes in front of the laptop or search for regular grocery and staple stuff. It should be just on the go and very fluent shopping. We did not think took a decision that it should not be through a mobile website. It should be through a regular mobile application. That might not be true for any other platform as well. So I don't think it's a zero or one question for any of these.
Great. Okay, thank you. So I'm going to open it up to you guys, the audience. So a great opportunity for you to get some insights from different people on the panel here. So questions, please, if you just raise your hand. So chat at the back, there's a guy, I think he's put his hand up first, right in the middle, right at the back. Please get a microphone. Gentlemen.
Hello, this is Bhavna.
Okay, sorry, not the gentleman. Ladies on the microphone first. But after that, please. Oh, no, she's going to be nice. Okay, thank you.
Hi, my name is Abanshu. I'm from MEC Group M. So I just want to know that what are the strategies a brand should take up when they're having small budgets and they are starting a new business for mobile marketing?
Great.
Oh,
I can't answer.
Okay, you can come to us.
That's not the answer we want. So the question is essentially limited budget startups. How can they leverage this medium, right? Mobile medium.
Yeah,
as well.
With limited budget.
You know, I mean, the best way is to go where your consumer is going and don't take the easy way out. I mean, buying IPL is the easiest thing in the planet. IPL title sponsor is the easiest thing in the planet. You just need to have 200 crores to burn. Okay, that's it. And what you're achieving out of it? Just because Pepsi IPL or a DHL, whatever, like, I forgot the name of the company also, DLF, right? Imagine. So and I'm in Gurgaon, by the way. So the point I'm making here is very clear. The point is, you should not be apologetic about small business. That's not the starting point. The starting point is when I read my MBA like 12 years back, I was taught that the advertising budgets are decided based on objectives. So what is your objective? If you want to play in sector 54 of Gurgaon, that's where your consumer lies, that's it, your question is solved, yeah? But if you want to play in Gurgaon, then there's another question. Play in Delhi, there's another question. You want to play all India, there's another question, right? So the question is, what is your business all about? What are the business metrics? What has your boss asked you? That I want 10% growth, for which I need 50% up in leads, 60% up in conversion, whatever that number is. So start from there, you know. Long time back when we used to do our campaign planning, the way we used to start is like we used to start from an Excel sheet, saying that, you know, okay, India, SEC, AB, above 18 years of age, how many households? Next thing is how many households are reachable by TV? Next is if they come to know about my, if I advertise, how many of people will see me? If they come to see me, like how many of people will actually want to buy me? Then the next thing is if you want to buy me, they go out, which are places my products are available? And thing is like, what will they stock out rate? And then we used to arrive at a number. The point I'm making is, it's not a question of, so to cut a long story short, so that's an objective-based method of campaign planning. But small budget, what you can play is you can play on communities. Today, communities are big. You need to figure out what is the purpose for your consumer. What is the purpose which your consumer will definitely enjoy? Figure out which are the blogs talking about it. Figure out which are the social media pages talking about it. Make a content for 50,000, 60,000 or 1 lakh worth of video, but which is like awesome, kick-ass thought, concept. So, when you have less of a budget, you have to play extraordinary. It's not budget forward. It's about your objective forward. I don't know if this honestly, I mean, there's no fixed answer to that. I mean, if you tell me the brand, if you tell me the budget, I can make a campaign for you. And it's possible.
Advisory services available from Prabhakar. But on the other side, though, in terms of, let's say, let's take an example. Let's say it's an app company, tech company with an app out there, and they're a startup. You guys offer models for performance-based campaigns as well, so they can pay based on performance as well. Is that a sensible route for a startup? Because I've got 5 lakhs of budget, 10 lakhs of budget, get me maximum impact for this, I'll pay for performance. That works?
So, we've got, for example, with our company, we actually work with companies like startups as well. So they come up with the budgets of like close to 50,000 rupees for a campaign. We also work with companies like, you know, the Mitra or, you know, Grofers, I think we also work with you. So we work with the biggies and the startups. So it depends really on what type of campaign. So some of them, they say, okay, I need a 20% sale for the users who actually come. So they want more KPIs. So here what happens is like, there are a few startups who actually want big numbers, like say more users, like in bulk users, so which they can actually go to the for the evaluation purpose also. It's going to be they say, okay, I've got a 1 million users or 2 million users or so. But there is another case where they say, okay, I got only budget of 50,000, but I need really good users. So it depends really on what the the company is looking for. So, but there is a solution for everything. There's a cost per sale, cost per registration. For example, we now do cost per registration. So what happens is the user not only installs the app, but also registers, and then the billing is done. So basically, it's foolproof. You can't go wrong there. So even if you're having less budgets, you can get a better better chances of conversion.
I think, sorry, just to add something here. As a brand, I don't think you should be spending a lot on different channels and different media channels or digital channels or something. If you have less budget, spend on making those first 5 customers happy came to you, they are going to multiply so much, and they're going to, you know, spread your word so much in their community that you will never be able to reach out to those people through any channel which is available out there. Any touch point that a customer has with you, be it a, for us it's a delivery subject, my whole experience depends upon how my delivery boys goes and delivers the stuff to you and how do you feel about it. For Myntra, Flipkart, everything is same. For a different business, it might be a different touch point. Spend money on those first five to 100 customers who have come to you, have done something with you, and if you have made them happy, you're not going to lose them. Those 100 people are going to get you next 1,000 and next 10,000 and next 1 million. It's never a channel game or anything. It's only about the touch point if the customer feels happy or not. I'll give you a very small example. We started back in last year, December, right? So when we started doing promotions and, you know, first initial months, we never had, at least the focus was not to burn all the money just through marketing. We started a very small campaign. We gave 1 mango free with every order for 1 day. And I'm telling you, that's probably the best campaign we have ever tried. Out of experience, because the number of people who felt happy about it, just because it's a very small product, people feel connected, and they said, okay, it's a season, I'm anyway going to go out and look out for this, so that nothing else made my customer more happy than that. Spend money on that.
Mango madness. Sorry, that lady who kindly gave the microphone, if you give the microphone back to her, please, and let her just ask the question.
Hi, this is Bhavna. I'm starting up a company called Happies, and I think I'm at the right moment, at the right time, right place. I'm going back to the discussion which Lavin and Venkatesh had about having mobile apps or not. So currently I'm facing the same dilemma. I feel mobile apps are like very, 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 very well reachable. But again, the problem is, you cannot install all the apps. You have limited space on your phone. So even today I wanted to install a very good app for a woman, but I mean, I ran out of space. So now I'm feeling which way to go. So Venkatesh has touched upon many points, but he didn't touch upon this point. What do you do when you, like, the common user has limited space. Not everybody have, like, iPhones and all. Common users are having Samsung Galaxy. This is the most commonly used smartphone. So how you deal with that? And then there's a lot of competition between different companies to go onto the smartphone of that user. So how you actually you fight for that space and how you handle that. And I think it also can be a startup idea to do something about it.
Interesting. I hope everybody listened to that. There's an opportunity.
So actually, if you see, for getting on top of the rankings, there is SEO which needs to be done for any mobile web. So similarly, there is ASO which needs to be done for the apps. So discoverability is very important. You may have a mobile web or you may have an app, but first you need the user to discover it. So it really depends on how well your mobile web is done or your app. So you concentrate on any one technology or one method and go towards that. If you feel that you are very strong on, you know, getting your mobile ranked, your mobile website ranked, you can go that route. So you don't have to worry. So when a user actually uses mobile and searches, then the chances of your website coming on top is there. So you get users directly to your website. But if you feel that you can reach out to the users like through when they search on the App Store, so they go to Google Play or go to the App Store and in this search for that particular keyword, and then your app comes in the top for the relevant searches, then the chances of them discovering the app is there. But then whatever it is, as you said, it's very important that the about the space in a particular available on a device. So not more than, I think, 40 apps are there in an average in a particular mobile phone. That's an average at least in India. So which should be the app being in the top, in one of those 40 is a it's like a dream. If it is there, it's great. So you would definitely find apps like Facebook, YouTube, or Twitter, or not Twitter, maybe something like Ola or being there, definitely it will be there. So you have to discount all those, and so your 50% is gone there itself. Now, in the other 20, your app has to be there. So which is definitely a tough thing. So again, what is unique in your app amongst your peers? That is very important. So if you are able to do that, then so it's basically the quality of the app. If your quality is there and you're able to reach, first you need to reach. Second is your app has to have this uniqueness to stand out from the competition. If you have these two, then you are having a good chance of being there. Otherwise, the best way is for mobile web, for which you need to do a lot on the mobile, on the SEO front.
Oh, that's exactly the point I was trying to make, right? Mobile web, at some point your phone is going to run out of space and you do not want your consumer to choose an app only. So which means he has to sacrifice something else to install you. That's just negative experience. Like holding a consumer ransom that no, the only way you can do it is uninstall someone else and install me, that's bad experience. So you need to have mobile web, need to have a and make sure it's a responsive site so that the other person goes through a desktop or through a mobile web or through a tablet. It's, you know, it's responsive. And remember, it also depends on, I mean, I don't know what your business is. Like, what was the app again? What was the function of your business?
My business is about helping people getting access to a psychologist online.
Okay.
But I'm not talking about this particular application which I wanted to install. It was like some, because I'm in the process of deciding whether to go web or to mobile app.
Well, I would recommend for a business like yours to stick to mobile web. Or be a part of another community like Urban Club or some of these other vendors where they actually already have an app for that sort of use and you're a subset within that. Because, I mean, for a very for something so specific such as yourself, I would highly recommend just the mobile web, because you're not going to have people wanting to discover psychologists on their cell phone, right? It's someone who will actively search for it. When they search for it, you've got to be found on the web and you've got to be present there. So I would highly recommend mobile web. It depends on the use case, right? It depends on business to business.
And I'd like to add a couple of, just one point to that. Yes, definitely mobile web is definitely more suitable here, but you could have an add-on app which could actually, which could be a thing, but again, it's yeah, the most recommended is the mobile one.
Thank you.
Alright. Sorry, so where's the microphones? Can I have one at the front? Sorry, he's got one in his hands. Can I tell him to do then this chap at the front here, please?
Alright, thank you. Hi, I'm Nikhil. I'm from Bangalore. We work in an integrated ad agency called PayU. So first of all, it was a lovely session. I'm actually going to ask you a question which we face in our work every day. Because we do a lot of mobile-first campaigns with a lot of apps. The question is this. Irrespective of which mobile network you're on, unless you have Wi-Fi, the chances of you getting a good, powerful 4G connection is actually very less. Right? Even in the heart of Bangalore, like Indranagar. Given that situation, and given the fact that content marketing is actually king, we need to make the richest of content, the richest of videos or images that are actually heavy, what would you recommend in terms of best practices to actually keep content the king, at the same time take into consideration that people may not have the bandwidth to download it, and also not be intrusive on your 5-inch screen?
Okay, so some network considerations as well, and given that people do have limited speeds. So from a brand marketer side, how do you sort of tackle that or think about that for the audience you're trying to reach?
I think for us it was a different scenario a little bit. We started with a very specific use base, which I knew is going to own either a premium smartphone or a, he will have access to good internet connection, and I do not think that it changes the whole strategy around it, that my user probably will not have internet connection which is strong enough that it will even be able to load my ads or any communication. So I personally have never come across any big problem which was only related because that, you know, my ads are not being shown or I've not been able to reach my customer because they're not probably on 4G. So I think as far as you keep your ads light and, you know, the publishers can help you out with that, but it was never really a big problem for us to solve.
You had the campaign you're talking about where you said...
The campaign, right. But you know what, I mean, like, I would still prefer not to call that campaign because that's one of the campaign for one of the brand I have worked for, which is still... I mean, I have worked for the brand which are like having 85% penetration in this country. You know, I have sold tires, I have sold hair oil, and I'm now selling wallets, okay? So I won't rely on that. I will tell you very frankly, as a marketer, how I think at the problem, even if I have that problem that you're having. See, content is the king. Not the heaviest content is the king. No, the most advanced 3D, 100 GB file is the king. The question is, and I will give you, but while giving you this philosophical answer, I'll give you a very simple answer. If it can be forwarded in WhatsApp, there's a size. Go for it. Because wherever the person is, and if he's in Bangalore, he would love to watch that video in the WhatsApp. And he will do whatever it takes. Okay. And so if your content, you know, in terms of quality of the content, you know, the 4G and Wi-Fi doesn't matter. There you have to think hard and you have to break your head and your client head if need be, but find out a content which will work, okay? And for the size, I can only tell you that if it can be transferred by WhatsApp, you're home. Because there's no magic pill, because when you design something, you don't design constraint forward. You design opportunity forward. And then you tackle the constraint. Your first question would be, what is it which will like spread like fire? What is it which will excite my consumer so much that he will like to share? What is it that will tell about my consumer, about my product and service that they will go, ki aaj hi kharidna, abhi kharidna, chalo kharidte hain. That's a bigger problem to solve. Not the fact that ki Indira Nagar mein 4G nahi hai. I'm sorry, here's the example, but this is how I personally think about such problems. So very clearly, content is the king, focus on the content. In terms of the constraint, I will tell you, if the video could be exchanged in the WhatsApp, I think you're home with that.
So the gentleman just here, he'd been asking a while ago, your microphone here, please, right at the front, here. Yeah.
It was a wonderful session. I have two questions. Okay, my name is Mukhil and I run a company called, it's a new company called Urban Wand. Okay, it's primarily focused to customers in the mall area, taking through the entire journey of search and discovery and engagement. One question, Lavin, is to you. You did mention initially about something called ad units. Okay, could you go a little deeper into that? What exactly it is? Sounds to be a little interesting than banners and videos which we already heard about.
We actually have a booth outside too. You can stop over and we can give you a much more detailed breakdown. But what we've done is, I'll keep it really crisp. We're India's first storytelling platform for brands on mobile. So if you want to tell an effective story, we feel that simple banners are not effective at doing that. We've actually recreated the mobile ad from ground up, thinking from a mobile first mindset completely, realizing that you need a full inch, you need a full screen ad to really tell a story. You need to build in, you need to take all the different sensors that the phone offers and stitch that into your storytelling experience. And that's when you can really make the emotional connect. A simple banner ad is just vanilla. So I can go over details, stop by our, yeah, we have a booth outside. I can take you over in more detail.
Sure, thanks. And thank you very much. I think I'll connect with you once. Recently. And one, Sharad, this is for you. I know you're done from a campaign which is like, you know, having a mango and then getting a good success of it. And I'm sure you'd have had campaigns which have spent a lot and not resulted in much. Okay, what is a good CPA? And what you'd call is an odd, and what is an average in your, from your experience, cost per acquisition. Sorry.
So, I personally feel, I mean, cost per acquisition is a very shallow metric to look at. You can explore areas where you can, you know, get CPAs as low as 50, 60. We have, interestingly, we started selling Patanjali products, and our cost of acquisition was 42 rupees in that day. that was through Facebook, right? But that's very shallow metric to look at. For me, if someone clicked on an ad and saw my application because we were selling Patanjali products, but that probably was not the guy who would use who is very used to mobile applications, he's not a good acquisition for me anyway, right? So when we evaluate our campaigns, it's more of what the lifetime customer value is for us rather than just looking at cost of acquisition. Definitely cost of acquisition plays a big role when we talk about it. Should I go ahead with the publisher or not? Should I go with that channel, this channel? But then that's still just one metric that we look at, not the entire thing.
So what is the metric that you would use?
If a person is coming back again and again making multiple orders or not.
It's a lifetime value, is it, right? It's cost per quality acquisition.
If a customer came through an ad just because I was displaying a coupon code, he never came back because I never sent anything else after that. Not a good acquisition for me. I would rather spend double the amount on a customer who is going to come back again and again and transact without coupon codes or without mangoes or without anything else, rather than getting something or someone from at rupees 42 who is not even going to purchase Patanjali products for us.
Okay, thanks.
Just you have the. Then you'll have the last question. Okay. Get the mic to the lady in the back. The hand up next to the gentleman in the blue shirt.
Hi, I work with Nikhil from Brave New World. My question specific to Lavin about mobile first campaigns, right? So, like you said, you probably thought like only social first brands are actually looking at mobile, but what we see with our experience is actually a lot of traditional brands also understand the value of mobile. I think it's pretty very clear for people, you know, who researched and looked at their consumers that they have to do mobile first. The challenge that they face is I don't think there's a one solution that fits all for categories. And you guys being the expert in the domain, I just want to know, how do you all pitch this, you know, as in there can be different solutions for different categories, because the way, and we also look at solutions to clients saying, you know, if this is your category, this is your audience, your mobile strategy needs to be completely different. But right now, I feel like that education either has to come from, you know, mobile expert providers to kind of put that out. Is there something that you're doing in that area which we can also leverage in our, you know, creative campaigns?
Sure, it's a very valuable point that you bring up. You know, in our journey in, you know, working with all the brands, what we've seen is they want to do something on mobile, but the problem is most of the agencies that they work with, they're so hell-bent on doing their basic stuff, which is, let me just buy it on GDN, let me just buy it single banners, right? They're just so stuck on that. And again, I hate to say this, but as much as it's truly the agency's function to do this, I think the agencies are stuck with a lot of old people, and you know, they don't want to change their ways of working. It's, you know, they're stuck in a comfort zone. And I hate to say this, but some of the largest agencies in this country are stuck in that zone. So what we're doing is we're literally going to the brand. We're actually consulting them in the entire creative development process, because when we tell the agency is like, well, we're not going to create this. This is not a basic banner. We don't do anything beyond a basic banner, because their mandates just have basic banners. So what we see is, you know, the whole process.
I'll tell you that later, but
yeah. Well, the whole process of creating content as well as creating the creative, both of these are key areas where I think there's a big gap in our country. You know, I think most of the digital marketing companies also are not really fulfilling that gap. Most of the digital marketing companies are creating websites and just doing some social stuff, but no one's truly playing that function of bridging that communication divide of how to speak effectively to consumers on mobile. I'll give you an example here, right? So there was this very prominent brand which wanted to do their age-old CPL format inside our ad unit. And we're like, hey, you know, these new age consumers are not going to fill out forms on the mobile phone. It's harder. But they were so hell-bent. We're like, why don't we propose an easier method of, like, you know, maybe do a quick click-to-call, because that's easy. So the user is really interested, click-to-call, they'll call you, capture the phone number, and have your, you know, sales process sort of behind it. But they're like, no, we need the email address, we need the name, we need this, we need the age. We're like, wait, you're just creating hindrances. But now if brands do not understand that, they need to understand, like, again, going back to what, you know, what Sharad was saying, or what I think Prabhakar was saying, which, you know, you need to, it's consumer first. You need to understand how your consumer is going to behave on mobile, and then make sure that your communication and whatever media you're using actually fits to that. So what we as a company are doing is we're consulting the brand in the entire process. We're consulting the agencies as well. We're helping them make the creatives. We actually have an in-house studio that makes all the creatives, and we don't even charge for all this.
So I'm not talking about the creative output, right? As in, we get that as agencies, and as Brave New World, we're from mainline agencies who didn't understand what you just said, and that's why we're the startup communication agency, because we get that, isn't that's not how you approach it, and I completely agree with that. But my point is a platform story, right? Like a category or an industry, the way you approach mobile is completely different. So I'm talking about the...
Just ask it. Only one. Okay, got the mic.
Thank you everyone for the session. It was a great session. I'm Manas from Hyatt Hotels and Resorts. My question is slightly different than the ones which we've actually been asking for all this while. Of course, the most important thing which we've already discussed is one is storytelling, which undoubtedly is the way forward moving. But, you know, finding the right target market through big data, because unless we know the right data, I don't know how we're going to target it, because I'm talking about an industry like a hotel, wherein the market mix is extremely complex. If we talk about a brand website of a company, which is hotels, we get bookings all over the world. So where we are targeting, how we are getting the data from, and how would it really make an impact in the future? That's the question which I wanted to pose across.
So I guess you're asking, wait, what is the data that you're getting to be able to do the targeting? Yeah?
What is the importance of big data here when it comes to targeting the right customer?
Oh, well, big data. So think of it this way. So storytelling has never been out of fashion, right? So from the days of TV, from the days of radio, storytelling was very key there. What's happened is in the recent world of digital and mobile, storytelling has got very diluted and murky, because everyone's like, hey, let's just get installs, let's just get this, let's get, you know, click CPA and CPC and like, it's gotten very murky, and what we're doing is we're bringing that back. But you can't just simply bring back storytelling without using big data. So to bring about the true effectiveness, you have to understand the consumer, you know, make sure that you have all the effective data points on his, you know, behavior and his patterns and like what he, you know, on his demographics if you can, and really target effectively. So we see that big data from a targeting perspective plays a very important role in our entire platform. Yes.
I still want to take this one. I think it's been more than a decade back, I read the book on Mr. Oberoi. I mean, he made the Oberoi hotels, you know, and he started by being a humble supervisor or something in one of the hotels in one of the hill stations. And when this great hotelier made his hotel, he made this hotel in whatever he has observed while he worked on the other side as a supervisor, right? And imagine the kind of imagination, kind of data this guy had to build an empire like Oberon's, right? But how many such people are around? You know, the question is not about can we have another Mr. Oberon, Mr. Hayat? I don't know if Hayat has been a person or what. But yeah, great. So the point I'm making is ki, this is where big data helps you. I mean, just to give you a thought as a marketer, because I think brands, okay? So a home away from home, if this is the core thought. Or let's put it like this, a luxurious home away from not so luxurious home. If that's what it is, okay? Then the question come in that how do you know that you've delivered on that? How many touch points are there? How do you know whether the consumer was happy there or not? One single person can't do it. That's where big data comes to the rescue. From the point the person stepped out of his car, to the point he reached the hotel, to the point he went to whatever, wherever he went, to the point he stepped out. There are so many data points getting generated. And not a single person is following that consumer. Right? Imagine if something, this data could be captured, and in the big data it help you take decisions. So that's where I want to leave you, not taking much time. Yeah.
Right, okay. So we have to close the session there. So I think we're running a little over late. I'd like to really thank Lavin, Venkatesh, Prabhakar, Sharad, and the audience as well for hopefully it's a very engaging session for everyone as well.
Thank you very much.